Good morning. Welcome to IFANS, the Institute of Foreign Affairs and National Security at KNDA, a Korean National Diplomatic Academy. You know, we are going to hear a lot of acronym today. Today we are very glad to join KAIST, Nuclear Nonproliferation Education and Research Center, NEREC, and the Korea Institute of Nuclear Nonproliferation and Control, KINE, to host jointly this 2019 International Conference on Nuclear Nonproliferation. As the theme of this year's conference, Promoting Nuclear Nonproliferation, shows, we are still struggling to make the world free from the threat of nuclear weapons. I'm afraid to say that this year, the world is somewhat more dangerous, unstable than last year, than we meet. Only a generation ago, we celebrated the end of history, meaning that there will be no more great wars and the beginning of permanent peace. Now, only a generation later, now we see the return of history, the return of geopolitics, and the return of a great power competition. If I take only a few cases, the US withdraws from the JCPOA, Iran nuclear deal, and intermediate nuclear forces agreement. That could let loose the nuclear genie out of the bottle. In this part of the world, inter-Korean summits and US DPRK summit succeeded in stopping the North Korean nuclear test and the long-range missile test. However, DPRK still might continue to produce nuclear fissile materials and the missiles that are causing some serious concerns to us. As we live in East Asia, there is no shortage of surprises and crises every year. Political and the security situations are fast changing, volatile, and uncertain. Recently, Japan's action to strengthen its export control against South Korean semiconductor companies and against Korea itself is causing very strong response here. As you can see on the street, South Korea has been members, contrary to the position of Japan, South Korea has been members of all four international exporter control regimes, ranging from Wassenaar Arrangement, Australian Group, MTCI, Missile Technology Control Regime, and Nuclear Suppliers Group, too, since the 90s. And Korea has been proud of being a leading country in implementing and promoting the value of nuclear nonproliferation and nuclear security. Seoul hosted 2012 Seoul Nuclear Summit successfully. And South Korea also took the chairmanship of 1540 Committee, Nuclear Supply Group, and the MTCR during the last 5 years. Despite the North Korean nuclear threats, South Korea firmly abides by non-proliferation, nuclear non-proliferation norms. Though our 20-something nuclear power plant justifies the needs of enrichment and the reprocessing capabilities, still we are living without them. Those are some of the problems that's causing our tension. Though it may not be the topic of topics of this conference today. Today, bright minds gathered here to look for answers to the questions of our gravest concerns. Through this conference, I hope that we could share visions of the world and the Korean Peninsula free from nuclear weapons and find pathways to the goals. Lastly, I want to thank you, those who traveled long hours for the conference. I especially Thank you. Would like to thank you, Professor Inman Sung, for making this great summer non-proliferation conference possible. We are happy to be part of it this year. At KNDA, we prepared a lot for the conference, but certainly not this hot weather today. However, I hope we could stay cool inside during the conference. Once again, we appreciate your participation to the conference, both as a panelist and the audience. And I hope that we learn from each other. Thank you very much.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is going to be a very warm day today. And despite what Mr. Chun just said, it seems that it would be very warm inside as well, with you, distinguished experts, discussing durably warm issues, including the denuclearization of North Korea. I welcome all of you to this annual NEREC conference on nuclear non-proliferation. This year's conference is co-hosted by the Korea Institute of Nuclear Non-Proliferation and Control, as well as the Institute of Foreign Affairs and National Security of the Korean National Diplomatic Academy. It is a great privilege of KAIST to co-host this year's conference with such distinguished national organizations. KAIST was founded in 1971 to support Korean industrial development and scientific and technological advance. Now it is aiming at becoming an institution, creating values that benefit the global community. KAIST established the NEREC, Nuclear Non-Proliferation Education and Research Center, in 2014 with the objective of contributing to peaceful and responsible use of nuclear energy and international nuclear non-proliferation. While still very young, we hope NEREC is emerging as a credible organization dedicated to these goals. The International Conference on Nuclear Non-Proliferation is NEREC's annual flagship event inviting global experts in nuclear non-proliferation. And this year's is the sixth in the series. In today's and tomorrow's sessions, the participants will identify key non-proliferation challenges on the horizon and propose strategies to meet them. The prospect of the nuclear denuclearization of North Korea and possible ways to facilitate strategies to meet them will be analyzed. Developments in non-proliferation verification technologies will be discussed along with the related policy and implementation issues. With some of the best minds of our day in the field and with the participation of young future leaders such as the NEREC Summer Fellows and Research Fellows, I hope and believe this year's conference will be fruitful with meaningful conclusions. I'm deeply grateful to all of you who are attending today's and tomorrow's sessions. Again, welcome to the conference. Thank you.
더불어민주당 한반도 비핵화 대책 특별위원회 위원장을 맡고 있는 심재권 국회의원입니다. 카이스트 핵 비확산 교육 연구센터가 주최하는 2019년도 핵 비확산 국제 회의를 진심으로 축하드립니다. 카이스트 관계자 여러분께 또 발제와 토론을 맡아주신 연세대 문정인 교수님, 스탠포드대 스콧 사강 교수님, 하버드대 스티브 밀러 교수님, MIT대 위핀 나랑 교수님, 또 한국과 미국, 중국, 일본의 핵 전문가 여러분께도 또 참석해 주신 여러 대변인께도 감사 인사 드립니다.
Good morning. I'm Shim Jae-gun, Chairman of the Special Committee on Denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula of the Democratic Party of Korea. It gives me great pleasure to congratulate the hosting of the 2019 International Conference on Nuclear Non-Proliferation by KAIST Nuclear Non-Proliferation Education and Research Center. I also would like to offer my appreciation to Professor Moon Jung-in of Yonsei University, Scott Sagan of Stanford University, Steve Miller of the Harvard University, Vipin Narang of the MIT, Imman Song of KAIST, nuclear expert from Korea, US, Japan, and China, and distinguished guests from home and abroad.
지난 2017년 북한의 9월 수소탄두 핵실험 그리고 뒤이은 11월에 ICBM 실험에 이어지면서 한반도는 일촉즉발의 전쟁 위기로 치달았습니다. 그러나 2018년에 접어들면서 북한의 평창 동계올림픽 참가 뒤이은 비핵화 의사 표명으로 오늘의 비핵화 회담 국면이 시작되었습니다.
With the testing of hydrogen bomb in September, followed by the ICBM test later in November, in the year 2017, the Korean Peninsula was at the tipping point with a crisis of war looming ahead. However, the mood changed in 2018 with the North Korean participation in Pyeongchang Winter Olympic Games, after which came an announcement of the East intention toward denuclearization, initiating the talks that are still underway today.
북한은 핵무기 개발을 체제 수호의 근간으로 판단해 왔습니다. 따라서 비핵화 용의를 표명하면서도 그 비핵화는 북한에 대한 군사적 위협 해소와 체제 안전 보장이 이루어질 때만 가능하며 또 비핵화와 이러한 보장들은 단계적이고 동시적으로 이루어져야 함을 조건으로 내세웠습니다.
For North Korea, the development of nuclear weapons constitutes the backbone of their strategy for regime survival. This is why, on one hand, North Korea showed its willingness to achieve denuclearization. On the other, they insist on the conditional and phased denuclearization process in which resolution of the military threat against them and regime guarantee are pursued simultaneously with the denuclearization process.
북한이 비록 조건부이기는 하나 비핵화 의사를 밝힌 데에는 두 가지 요인이 작용했다고 생각합니다. 첫째, 미국을 중심으로 한 국제사회의 제재와 압박은 북한의 소위 핵 경제 병진 노선의 한계를 가져다 주었습니다. 둘째, 수소탄도 핵실험 성공과 화성 15호 ICBM 발사 성공이라는 기본적인 핵무장의 성공함으로써 북한은 나름의 체제 수호를 위한 새로운 국제관계를 모색할 여력을 갖게 됐다고 생각합니다.
There seem to be two factors that have driven North Korea to express its intention to denuclearize, albeit conditional. First, international sanctions and pressure led by the United States have sharply identified the limit to North Korean Byongjin policy in which it pursues economic and military development in parallel. Second, its success in acquiring basic nuclear capabilities proven by the hydrogen bomb and the ICBM testings enabled North Korea to consider new international relations for the region's survival.
이 두 가지 요건 중에 하나만 없었어도 오늘의 비핵화 논의 국면은 시작되지 않았으리라고 저는 생각합니다. 잘 알려진 것처럼 지난해 6월 12일에 북미 싱가포르 정상회담은 한반도 비핵화와 평화체제 구축에 원칙적인 합의를 이루었습니다. 그러나 그 합의에 대한 구체적인 실현 방법을 놓고 그 후 진척이 이루어지지 않았으며 지난 2.27 하노이 정상회담에서도 양측은 합의를 이루지 못했습니다. 지난 6월 30일엔 판문점에서 극적으로 남북미 정상회담이 이루어지기도 했습니다. 한반도 평화 프로세스에 다시금 동력을 기대했습니다만 당시 북미 정상회담 간에 정상 간에 합의했던 양측 실무 회담은 그러나 아직 이루어지고 있지 않습니다.
As you all know, the US DPRK summit in Singapore on June 12th last year produced a basic agreement regarding denuclearization and establishment of the peace regime on the Korean Peninsula. However, there has been no follow-up for the delineating the concrete action for the agreement. The Hanoi summit on February 27 earlier this year ended up without a concluding agreement. Then on June 30th, the three leaders of the US and two Koreas had a dramatic trilateral meetings at Panmunjom. It reinvigorated hope for the Korean Peninsula peace process, but working level talks between the US and DPRK have yet to take place.
하노이 2차 북미 정상회담에서 북한은 영변 핵시설 폐기 용의를 표명하고 이에 상응하는 UN 제재 일부 해제를 요구했습니다. 그러나 미국은 비핵화 범주를 핵물질 생산 시설, 핵무기 제조 시설, 보유한 핵탄두와 핵물질, 그리고 ICBM, 그리고 생화학무기로 하고 이들에 대한 신고, 폐기, 검증, 확약과 포괄적인 비핵화 로드맵 등을 요구하며 이러한 조치가 먼저 이루어질 때까지는 제재 완화가 불가함을 주장, 양측이 합의에 이르지 못하였고 그 간극은 오늘 지금 이 순간에도 계속되고 있다고 생각합니다.
In the Hanoi summit, there was a gap in understanding of the scope of denuclearization between the US and DPRK, which led to the absence of the agreement from the meeting. North Korea expressed their willingness to dismantle the nuclear facilities in Yongbyon. Meanwhile, the US insisted on a comprehensive deal that includes report, dismantlement, and verification of the all elements that are related to the weapons of mass destruction program of North Korea. Until now, the gap remains unbridged.
한반도의 비핵화는 반드시 이루어야 할 과제입니다. 그러나 우리가 유념해야 할 것은 그 비핵화는 반드시 평화적으로 이루어져야 한다는 것입니다. 한반도에 다시 전쟁의 참화가 있어서는 안 됩니다.
The denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula is the utmost task that we must achieve. But we should always keep in mind that the denuclearization process must be achieved in a peaceful way. The tragedy of the war should never happen on the Korean Peninsula again.
평화적 비핵화 달성을 위해 저는 두 협상 측면을 강조하고자 합니다. 첫째, 평화적 비핵화는 한반도 평화 체제 구축과 함께 추동될 때만 가능합니다. 한반도 평화 체제 구축 문제는 한반도 비핵화 문제와 동전의 양면입니다. 둘째, 6.12 싱가포르 합의를 보다 구체화한 포괄적 로드맵 합의 위에 이 두 접근은 단계적이고 동시적으로 이루어져야 합니다. 70여 년에 걸친 북미 적대 관계와 불신에 비추어 비핵화와 평화체제 구축의 모든 측면이 일거에 이루어진다는 것은 불가능합니다.
I always underscore two factors that are necessary to consider for successful talks for denuclearization. First, like two sides of a coin, peaceful denuclearization will be only possible when pursued along with the establishment of the peace regime on the Korean Peninsula. Second, building upon the agreement of the Singapore summit, a more concrete and comprehensive action plan should be adopted and implemented in a simultaneous and step-by-step manner. It is necessary to be mindful that establishment of denuclearization and peace regime on the Korean Peninsula cannot be achieved in one effort, and given the distrust and hostilities accrued for over the last 70 years.
비핵화 논의 과정에서 제재 완화 또는 해제 문제 논의 또한 불가피합니다. 평화 체제 구축에는 북미 적대 관계 해소가 필수입니다. 제재를 가하며 적대 관계를 해소한다는 것은 불가능합니다. 따라서 진정으로 한반도 비핵화를 이루고자 한다면 북한은 비핵화 정도에 상응하여 제재 완화 또는 제재 해제 문제가 반드시 함께 논의되어야 합니다. 선 비핵화 후 제재 해제 접근은 결코 비핵화를 이룰 수 없다고 생각합니다.
In the In the negotiation for denuclearization, it is inevitable to talk about lift or suspension of the sanctions on North Korea. Establishment of the peace regime requires normalization of the relations between the U.S. and DPRK, and imposing additional sanctions is not compatible with that process. Therefore, sincere effort for the denuclearization on the Korean Peninsula call for the discussion on the easing or lifting of the sanctions in correspondence to the level of denuclearization measures that are taken by North Korea. The approach which put denuclearization above the lifting sanctions will never lead to denuclearization.
북한은 그동안 다양한 기회에 비핵화 의지를 분명히 하면서 비핵화 조치에 따르는 상응 조치로 제재 완화 또는 해제를 요구해 왔습니다. 북한에 대한 UN 안전보장이사회의 마지막 제재 결의안인 2017년 12월의 제2397호 결의안도 북한이 비핵화에 호응해 올 경우 제재 조치들을 중단 또는 해제할 것을 규정하고 있습니다.
In many occasions, North Korea expressed its willingness to achieve denuclearization on the Korean Peninsula in return for the partial lifting of sanctions. The latest sanctions resolution, United Nations Security Council Resolution 2397, also leaves room for the lifting or suspending measures of sanctions depending on North Korea's compliance with it.
국제사회는 북한이 약속을 지키지 않을 것을 우려할 수 있습니다. 그러나 북미 양측이 스냅백 조치에 미리 합의하면 됩니다. 북한의 비핵화 정도에 따른 제재 완화가 이루어지더라도 만약 북한이 약속한 비핵화 조치를 지키지 않는다면 국제사회는 즉각 다시 제재를 가할 수 있을 것입니다.
The international community may well be concerned about North Korea not keeping its promises. However, this can be resolved by the North Korea and the U.S. agreeing on the snapback measures. The eased or lifted sanctions measures can be reinstated immediately after North Korea's failing to keep up with its denuclearization promises.
지난 하노이에서도 그랬고 앞으로의 실무 협상에서도 비핵화의 개념이 매우 중요한 의제가 될 것 같습니다. 저는 완전한 비핵화의 개념으로 국제사회가 라틴 아메리카나 동남아시아를 비핵무기 지대로 만들면서 도입한 비핵화 개념, 즉 핵무기의 제조, 생산, 실험, 취득, 배치, 저장 등을 금지하는 것을 완전한 비핵화의 개념으로 제안하고자 합니다. 이는 가장 간명하면서도 이미 국제사회에서 검증된 비핵화의 개념입니다. 비핵화 논의에 손쉬운 한 매듭을 마련해 줄 수 있다고 생각합니다. 우리 더불어민주당의 한반도 비핵화 대책 특별위원회에서는 지난 2.27 하노이 회담을 앞두고 트럼프 대통령에게 보낸 공안에서 이 비핵무기 지대 개념을 이미 제시한 바도 있습니다.
As was in Hanoi, defining a concept of denuclearization would be one of the most critical items in the agenda for the working level negotiation between the U.S. and the DPRK in the future. I would like to propose the concept of the complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula in a form of nuclear weapons free zone, which prohibits production, testing, acquisition, deployment, and storage of nuclear weapons. This is the most effective and simplest concept that were proven by the international community, and I believe that this can be also applied to the Korean Peninsula as well. The Special Committee on Denuclearization of the Democratic Party of Korea has already proposed this concept in official mail to President Trump before the Hanoi Summit.
한반도 비핵화는 한반도는 물론 동북아와 세계 평화를 위한 우리 모두의 공동의 목표이자 과제입니다.
The denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula is a common goal and task for peace, not only for Korean Peninsula, but also for Northeast Asia and the world.
아무쪼록 오늘의 이 국제회의를 통해 한반도 비핵화와 평화체제 구축을 위한 지혜로운 고견들이 모아질 수 있기를 기대합니다. 오늘 이 학회에 참석해 주신 국내외 전문가 여러분과 카이스트 핵비확산 교육센터 관계자 여러분들의 건승을 기원합니다. 감사합니다.
In closing, it is my sincere hope that many wise and excellent ideas for peace on the Korean Peninsula are discussed at this auspicious conference, And I extend my best wishes to all participants, the expert, and the staff of the KAIST NEREC. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Sunung Chang, and I used to be the professor of the nuclear engineering at KAIST for 36 years, and right now I'm the president of Handong Global University. Today I'm very glad to chair the keynote speech session, especially today's keynote speaker is Professor Scott Sagan of the Stanford University. But today, if you see the here, it summarizes his resume, and already you are 15 minutes behind on schedule. So to I'd like to minimize his introduction. And so today's session is the subject is what do Americans really think about the conflict with the nuclear North Korea? And I'd like to ask the Professor Sagan, and so you are already 15 minutes behind the schedule to make the all the other program on time. I'd like to make your presentation as short as possible. The other thing, the important thing, is I'd like to have more discussion time with you, so your topic. So that's why I'd like to invite you now. Okay, good. That's all welcome.
The cover slide is both humorous and menacing. An image by the Cuban artist Adel Rodriguez is humorous in that he is, I think, inspired by Donald Trump's calling Kim Jong-un the Rocket Man. But it's also menacing for those of us of an older generation, remember the end of the classic film Dr. Strangelove, in which Slim Pickens falls from a B-52 on a thermonuclear weapon and ignites a nuclear war. Rocket Man or Dr. Strangelove? Let's see, how do I... I think we should focus on some of the concerns that we all have about North Korea's acquiring nuclear weapons, because while both democracies and non-democracies have acquired nuclear weapons historically, I believe not since 1949 and Joseph Stalin acquiring the bomb, if we had a personalist dictator with this much personal power having acquired nuclear weapons. A dominant personal power is particularly challenging for deterrence. It is often said that for nuclear deterrence, you have to have individual rationality. I'm not sure that's true. I think you do need to have collective rationality and a checks and balances system, so if someone makes an irrational decision, others can compensate for it. And when you have someone who surrounds himself with yes men, who favor personal loyalty over professional competence or experience, or someone who can make decisions on a whim, you have particular challenges to the concept of nuclear stability. That's why I'm very strongly in favor of denuclearization over the long term, but also believe that we need to have arms control and a much more peaceful relationship with North Korea in the meantime while that is happening. For the sake of time, I will very quickly walk through my interpretation of recent events and then go right into the subject matter, which is based on a major survey experiment that Professor Ben Valentino from Dartmouth, who's with us today, Alita Howarth, a research assistant at Stanford, and I conducted last year, or this past spring. Remember, 2017 was the year of fire and fury, where Donald Trump at the UN in September said that Rocket Man is on a suicide mission for himself and his regime. And not only did President Trump occasionally make threats to meet with fire and fury, but he also did not only make deterrent threats, he made preventive war threats, saying in April 2017 that if North Korea best not make any more threats, they will be met with fire and fury the world has never seen. And in January 2018, Kim Jong-un announced that he had perfected the deterrent against the United States, no longer needed to test long-range ICBMs, and that he had a nuclear button on his desk. President Trump, rather than responding the way most statesmen would have during the Cold War, or even post-Cold War, responded in a rather sophomoric manner. Apologies to the sophomores here among the undergraduates. This is something even sophomores usually don't do. Talking about my button is on my desk and my button's bigger than his button and my button works. Now, we don't know, and I'll be very interested in the Q&A from South Korean specialists, what they think. We don't know why Kim Jong-un announced that he had perfected his ICBM forces capability to strike anywhere in the United States. Most Americans would, if you're developing a capability, have many more tests before you would deploy something. And there are three possible explanations for the January speech. One is that a moderate amount of reliability, even a minimal amount of reliability, is sufficient for the North Koreans. After all, they've deployed missiles in the past. Think about the Nodong MRBM deployed in 1994-95 after three tests and only one of them being successful. So maybe he feels he has enough. Possibly, second explanation, that Kim Jong-un was lying to his people in order to create some wiggle room so he could negotiate with the United States, getting worried about potential conflict and the sanctions. If he could declare that he had success, then he could wiggle and have a freeze and maybe have more limitations. And possibly, a third explanation, is that Kim Jong-un was not lying to his people. Perhaps he had been lied to by his scientists. Because in North Korea, if Kim Jong-un says, I want the November test to be successful, and I want to have a reliable capability by January, who would tell him, sir, I think we need more tests? I'm not convinced we have that extreme reliability. And my answer is we don't know which of those three explanations take place. But even then, in starting the negotiations, we had some rocky roads. John Bolton famously in April 2018, prior to what eventually became the Singapore summit, said that he wanted to lay out the US goal as the Libya model, that we would demand a turnover of all nuclear materials and technology and weapons the way we did with Libya in 2003 and 2004. And President Trump, whether deliberately or not, I do not know, upped the ante by changing the term Libya model to Gaddafi model, personalizing it and adding a menacing note of murder, because we all know what happened to Gaddafi. But the model, and I quote President Trump from May, if you look at the model with Gaddafi, that was a total decimation. We went in there to beat him. Now that model would take place if we don't make a deal, most likely. We did make a deal at Singapore. All arms control agreements have a mixture of specificity and ambiguity. Usually a lot of specificity and a small amount of ambiguity for details to be worked out later. The ratio of ambiguity to specificity in this one was off the charts. Because we don't know of the four agreements made in the summit what the priorities were, what the timing would be, what complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula actually meant to both sides. Moreover, President Trump claimed afterwards that Kim Jong-un had promised personally not to have any more long-range tests, but how they were defined was not clear. And then he added a personal commitment that we wouldn't have provocative exercises, but what was a provocative exercise versus what is a defensive, well-meaning exercise were never defined. Hanoi failed on both sides, as Pyongyang and Washington both decided to go for broke Pyongyang wanting to get most of the sanctions removed for the Yongbyon complex, the United States wanting to have everything, not just the Yongbyon complex, turned over. And I think Donald Trump does deserve credit for at least restarting the process with the DMZ meeting. But given this enormous roller coaster ride that the Korean people, the American people, the North Korean people, the Japanese people, the whole world is, the Chinese people, the whole world has gone through of seeing threats of war and also claims of love letters being exchanged between the North Korean and the American leadership, what's the American public to think about this? The polls that existed until Professor Valentino and I did this work, I think, were exceedingly faulty. The best example of this is a Gallup 2017 poll, which was widely reported in the papers to demonstrate that the American public supports going to war, with 58% of the public saying that they would support military action if I could read the statement up above for those of you in the back who can't read it. The question was, if the United States does not accomplish its goals regarding North Korea with economic and diplomatic efforts, would you favor or oppose using military action against North Korea? The majority of the public, the papers reported, supports going to war. But that question is so vaguely worded that we cannot get proper inferences from it. What are the American goals? Doesn't say. Is military action a war? Or is military action a limited strike? Is military action a blockade? It doesn't say, so we don't know what the public was voting for. And moreover, and perhaps most importantly, the public in these kinds of polls are never told what the estimates are of what the consequences would be. So if someone says, I support going to war, or I support military action, we don't know whether they think that it would be 100% successful and there wouldn't be casualties, or whether they think that there would be casualties in the US or in the ROK, and what they would be. We don't know whether they're accepting of casualties or whether they're thinking that that won't occur. So what Professor Valentino and I did was hire YouGov, one of the leading firms, and for reporters in the room, we have copies of the article both in the handout booklet, and I've got some additional ones here if you want to get some of the details. And we tried to solve this problem of what are the estimates by asking people to read a story in which the president is considering airstrikes in response to North Korea starting launching long-range ICBMs capable of hitting the United States again. They are told in the story here, as you can see in the bottom right-hand side, that if a U.S. airstrike is successful, there'll be 5,000 civilians in North Korea, 10,000 military killed. And in South Korea, there'll be 30,000 killed from North Korean conventional retaliation. And yet, if the airstrike is not completely successful, there'll be 5,000, a total of 15,000 North Koreans, 30,000 South Koreans killed from conventional, and there'll be, if they're capable of hitting the United States, 300,000 Americans killed. And what we did was divide up our respondents into different groups. And what makes a survey experiment an experiment is that you alter one factor. Thanks. This one better? You alter one factor in a different condition so you can see, like in a scientific experiment, how that one change influences public opinion. So we have one condition where the continental United States has a 10% chance of being hit by three nuclear weapons. Condition two, where we say the United States is not at risk. A condition in which a U.S. strike is only 50% successful, so that there is a 50% chance that the United States will be hit with 300,000 Americans killed by three nuclear weapons from North Korea. A fourth condition and a fifth condition in which the United States does not attack with conventional weapons, but with nuclear weapons. To measure whether there's a taboo, and in the last question, to measure whether there's a non-combatant immunity norm, because here we say that a million North Korean civilians would be killed if the United States launches a nuclear strike to try to get at North Korean nuclear capabilities. We also have one condition I'll report on briefly, which shows what the American public would think if North Korea attacked a U.S. ship, like the famous incident that happened here a number of years ago. Okay? So here are the results. What does the American public really think? The first message I want to get is the most important one. In contrast to that earlier Gallup poll I just showed you, which didn't have any sense of the casualties involved, under every one of our conditions, whether it's 10% chance or whether there's conflict just on the Korean Peninsula and in the region, or a 50% chance, in none of the polls did the public support the United States launching a preventive war, even if North Korea starts retesting long-range missiles. And that's a very important bottom line that Professor Valentino and I want to get across. What could we do in the long term? Well, that's less clear. Only 33% of the public said that they thought the United States can learn to live with a nuclear-armed North Korea. When asked whether you trusted North Korea's leader, Kim Jong-un, to make rational decisions when it comes to the use of force, only 12% of the American public said they agreed with that. I should note, however, that when asked whether President Trump would make you trust them to make rational decisions, 45%, so still less than a majority, thought that of Donald Trump. So I will briefly go through these, and if Professor Valentino ever wants to add a point, feel free to jump in. We can get you a microphone, Ben. Here's a chart that just shows both some comforting news and some disturbing news. Again, the comforting news, if you look at the preference, which is the blue dot, under every one of the conditions, whether the U.S. is at risk, not at risk, 50% at risk, whether the nuclear strikes or an attack on a ship, under no conditions does the United States public approve, does it prefer using a military strike, with the one exception. If the North Koreans start a war, then the United States public, even when told that the North Korean would respond by attacking the United States, the majority of the American public say, go do it anyway. They've attacked it, they've started it. But the majority does not want, under all those conditions, to support going to war. That's also true for a limited conventional airstrike to signal U.S. resolve, not shown in this figure, similar to the bloody nose strategy that other people have written about. When asked, as I mentioned, do you think we can live with a nuclear Korea, only 33% said yes. But asked if Kim Jong-un could be deterred from using nuclear weapons against the United States or South Korea by the threat of a devastating U.S. retaliation, 65% said yes. And when asked whether the U.S. retaliation should target the North Korean population or Kim Jong-un's personal survival and political power, 52% said they believed that threatening Kim Jong-un's personal survival and political power is the most likely way to deter North Korea. Going back to and that actually is reflective in some ways with the U.S. nuclear posture review. Going back to the preferences and approval, you see something that is a bit more disturbing, which is that in every one of the scenarios, when asked, regardless of you prefer using military force, what would you do if the president did it? Would you approve of it? The difference between prefer, your personal preference, and approval, your political approval if it was done, you see a rally around the flag effect in many of the conditions where the public, while saying that they don't prefer something, they're willing to rally around the flag and support this. For example, only 33% of the public prefers a U.S. preventive nuclear strike that would kill 15,000 North Koreans, but 50% of the public said that they would approve it, which I find disturbing. I should note, however, that historically, rally around the flag effects are common. The public tends to support its president or its leadership, but they're not very long lasting. Because if things go wrong, that plummets. So you should take that with an enormous grain of salt. The one case where you see it going above 50%, again, is if the North Koreans attack a U.S. ship. This is a good news for extended deterrence, but also a good news in the other conditions for those of us who think that engaging in a preventive strike would be foolhardy. The public is, however, deeply worried as well about the risk of an accident, with over 70% saying that it's likely that in 10 years North Korea might experience an accident or unauthorized use of its nuclear weapon. Here you have Kim Jong-un smoking a cigarette while standing next to a liquid-fueled Hwasong 14 ICBM, a practice that was very dangerous, but one that you can't imagine an engineer or a military officer saying, "Sir, I recommend that you put out your cigarette." More seriously, remember the incident in September 2017 that alarmed many in the United States when an American emergency warning operator announced that there was a ballistic missile inbound to Hawaii, and the announcement said that this is not a drill. Many people in Hawaii panicked, fleeing outside, which is not what you should do. You should go stay inside in case there's fallout in the area. But in Washington or in Omaha, no one panicked. Why? For three reasons. We had redundant warning systems, none of which said that there's an attack coming. Two, we have professional operators and warning system personnel who said, "We screwed up. This was a mistake," immediately. And third, we did not actually think that North Korea was about to attack. So we assumed that this was a false warning rather than assuming it was a real attack coming. Now, I'd like you to imagine that something like this incident happened in North Korea today. Would any of those three conditions that helped ameliorate the situation in the United States take place? A, they don't have a lot of redundant warning systems. So if one of them malfunctioned or there's a human error that produced a false warning, you wouldn't have a lot of other systems reporting that no, there's no attack coming. Second, instead of having professional people who acknowledge mistakes, you have yes men who are worried about losing their lives, not just their jobs. And the likelihood that they would report a mistake, I think, is less. And lastly, I believe North Korean leaders are often worried about a United States attack. Why? Because we keep telling them that we might attack them. So some of the threats that President Trump has made, whether being genuine or being bargaining, have a negative impact on the likelihood of response to a false warning. Let me talk a little bit about some of the conditions that the characteristics of individuals before I close that help explain some of the hawkish minority, the people who want to go to war under all these conditions or are easily manipulated. We asked a series of questions that tried to help us understand what are the individuals thinking about when they're acknowledging going to war. So for example, one surprise was that the public was more willing, still a minority, but more willing to start a war with North Korea after they successfully had a test that said that there was a 10% chance of hitting the United States than before. And why that is, I think, explained by one statement made by one of the individuals who voted that way, who said, look, there's a 10% chance that they could attack us now if we attack first. There's a 100% chance if they attack, that they'd attack us if we don't do something about it now, so let's take the risk. A belief that North Korea is doing what it's doing out of aggression, rather than for deterrent purposes, I think underpins that argument. But other factors are very important. Here you see in the red squares that people who say in the post-survey questions that they are supportive of Donald Trump are much more likely to support going to war across the different conditions. You see that people who hold personal retribution beliefs, one of the factors that most strongly correlates with willingness to go to war in these surveys and many others that we've conducted, is whether you believe in the death penalty for convicted murderers. There's something about a retributive belief that says if someone that they deserve to die because of what they've done, that also lets many of our respondents say we should start a war with North Korea. Lastly, you can see here in the blue that there's a massive difference in support for war depending on whether you think that U.S. missile defense is perfect or near perfect. Many Americans, unfortunately it may include President Trump, who said that we had a 97% chance of shooting down a North Korean missile. I know of no expert who has that high degree of confidence. Many Americans think that it is likely. 77% say that we could successfully destroy our North Korean missiles in an offensive attack. And 33% said, yeah, we have a 75% chance. And those factors are strongly correlated to whether you're willing to go to war. The public's not being irrational here, but it's being very badly misinformed. And so I conclude here, as I conclude with Ben Valentino and Alita Haworth in the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists article that summarized this research in June, that we need to have a real effort at education of the public, not just about nuclear power, nuclear energy, and nonproliferation, the subject that we're getting at today, but also about the limits of the use of military force, about how dangerous military actions really would be. During the Cold War, I think there were major efforts. Here you see the famous issue of Daedalus called arms control that got the public to understand that you don't have to choose between disarmament and an arms race. You could actually have arms control agreements. And you see Rebecca Slayton's wonderful book about how scientists and engineers helped convince the public that the anti-ballistic missile treaty was a really good thing because anti-ballistic missiles might not work very effectively. And we need to do very similar kinds of education of the public in the United States, and I would suspect in North and in South Korea as well. Let me conclude here, but again, let me just note that many years ago now, President Barack Obama renewed the commitment of the United States to work towards a world without nuclear weapons. That is still a very much a worthy goal, but before we can get anywhere close to that, we're going to have to practice arms control to have different kinds of agreements that can limit the risks that we have today rather than accept that risk for the hope that we will get eventual nuclear disarmament. I'll conclude there and take questions and comments. We have a little bit of time, but I know we have a panel that will be addressing these subjects more fulsomely afterwards. Thank you.
And I'd like to ask, you must identify yourself, but you can give the, you know, very essential comment or question. Okay, good, thank you.
Morning, I'm Erwin Tan, Associate Professor at Hankook University of Foreign Studies. Thank you, Professor Sagan. I'd like to direct my question to the Sagan-Waltz debate on whether nuclear proliferation is stabilizing or destabilizing. Your counterpart, the late Ken Waltz, has pointed out that increased nuclear proliferation is actually stabilizing because Waltz is building on the logic of mutually assured destruction and second strike capabilities. Now, given that North Korea is now moving towards the development of submarine-launched ballistic missile capability, that would give them the beginnings of a second strike capability. So if this is the case then, but I mean North Korea is still going to be a small country with a very small obsolete military and still a small nuclear arsenal. So assuming that North Korea does develop a small submarine-launched ballistic missile capability, what would this mean for the Sagan-Waltz debate?
Well, for those of you who don't know, I was engaged in a very long, prolonged debate with Kenneth Waltz about whether nuclear weapons to new parties would be stabilizing or not, with me taking the negative position. And I think some of the points I was making here about both organizational proclivities, individuals making bad decisions, was something that Ken Waltz would not have agreed with, and the idea about there being a risk of an accidental war or war caused by false warnings was something that he ignored in his work. So while I think building more reliable second strike capabilities can enhance rational deterrence by creating a fear of retaliation, I don't think that's sufficient and that we can't assume that there would be 100% confidence that the United States and North Korea would not get into a war despite having those costs engaged. I would also doubt, I would add, whether a North Korean submarine would be totally invulnerable to American anti-submarine warfare. That said, I think that North Korea already has some capability to attack the United States. How reliable, we don't know. They also have a capability to attack Americans here in South Korea and Americans in Japan. So America is already vulnerable, Americans are already vulnerable to an attack from North Korea. I don't think that deterrence does not exist, I just don't think it's 100% perfect. And for those of us who try to analyze it, I think we have to accept both sides to that, saying that it does add as a constraint on war, but a very imperfect constraint.
I'm Kai Vetter from UC Berkeley, professor in the Department of Nuclear Engineering. I like the results of the last analysis where you plot the correlations between the willingness to go to war and correlation like with the support of Trump or death penalty.
I think call the Modrian slide because of the different art pieces.
Yeah, not only is it very artful, of course, but it's, of course, a very important contents. In looking at the correlations. And right. You can certainly add other criteria, like you said death penalty, you can have probably the Second Amendment, like to where it went. But also more importantly, maybe, if you plot the college degree, like if you look at the correlation with the, can you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah. I can understand what you're saying. I'm just not sure what the answer is.
But, okay. Yeah, so yeah. The degree of education, like that certainly there should be a correlation as well, which is, I think, fundamentally for us more the message we need to address. Yeah. And you point out in your last slide that the nuclear education is critical, of course, to address and make people aware of what it really entails. However, I think it's much broader than just nuclear education. I think much broader the education in general in the United States is an important challenge we have to address. To overcome ultimately the correlation if you plot that in this way.
Yeah. I don't recall, and neither does Professor Valentino, the answers to, on different, in these different conditions with regard to education. I do recall in an earlier study published in International Security, we found that education was not one of the major factors that determined whether somebody was willing to use nuclear weapons, for example, or not. What we found there was that party identification was important. Republicans were more hawkish under these different conditions than were Democrats. The death penalty in that study, which was about Iran, not Korea, the people who supported the death penalty were significantly more hawkish, more willing to use force against civilians and use nuclear weapons. Younger people were more dovish than older people. Older people were more willing to use military force than younger people. And the most surprising finding in that, or one of the most surprising findings, was that women were as hawkish, and in conditions where many Iranians were being killed, in order to save American GIs, they were more hawkish than men were. And we think that is because women tend to be more dovish in most, not all, but most polls in the real world about going to war or getting out of wars, but they're doing that to protect their loved ones. And when forced to make a decision saying, do you accept risks to your own loved ones, or are you willing to go to war and kill innocent people on another side, women are as hawkish as men are. But I agree with you, the general point about having more education, not just on nuclear questions, but on just war doctrine and the laws of armed conflict and the real costs of what military force means.
Okay, Chairman, I'd like to ask one question to you. And as a Korean living in Korean Peninsula, I'm very worrying about there's some possibility of the preventive strike, whether it's low or high. But so you need somewhat a creative solution which can eliminate possibility of strike or war in Korean Peninsula. For example, some recently. American Defense University say it's a good way of the sharing the strategic nuclear weapon, tactical nuclear weapon sharing in the in Korea and Japan and U.S. like the NATO system. So maybe then it can be the eliminating the strike. Also, it can be the very strong incentive, the denuclearization of the North Korean nuclear weapon. But there's another many.
These would be
solution.
Controlled by Russian military people in North Korea. You're saying?
I'm talking about I'm talking about creative solution. Yeah. One solution is a tactical nuclear weapon sharing between U.S. and South Korea Japan. That's the one thing. So how do you think about the more creative solution? What is your personal opinion about this kind of creative solution?
Most creative solutions assume that the solution will work perfectly. And that's why people find them really attractive. T.S. Eliot once said that people try to avoid the darkness outside and within by dreaming up systems so perfect that no one needs to be good. I think sharing tactical nuclear weapons is a really bad idea, because while it can work in theory by sharing the risk, it creates all the kinds of dilemmas of lost weapons, of inadvertence, of somebody using a weapon when they're not authorized to do so, that we had during the Cold War, which is exactly why we got rid of tactical nuclear weapons when we realized some of the dangers involved.
Why in NATO? In NATO, they shared non-tactical nuclear weapon. Why not in this region?
Because South Korea and Japan should not do the stupid things that NATO does by storing tactical weapons on their soil.
Okay, good. Maybe you can have one more.
I did just, in response to Professor Vetter, I looked up that result, which we didn't report in any of the published work, but just so you know, yes, you're right. People with a college degree were less likely to support using any strike against North Korea across all the conditions. And that's even true when we control for every other variable we have, so education. Does seem to have a significant effect. People with a college degree, about 8% across the conditions, less likely to prefer striking. So,
okay. I'd like to list, have one more question. Dr. Lee, Lee Sang-hyun. Okay.
Well, I'm Sang-hyun Lee, a senior research fellow at the Sejong Institute and president of the Korean Nuclear Policy Society. Well, I absolutely agree that we need more education about nuclear issue. But how can you precisely achieve educational effect? What's the mechanism? So do you think about university education or any other kind of a mechanism? Let me give you one example. For example, I did a research project a few years ago about South Korean people's attitude about developing our own nuclear weapon. So usually in Korea, public opinion, more than 50% support developing its own nuclear weapon. But if public were given more information, for example, if South Korea developed a nuclear weapon, it will have some international economic sanctions or some disadvantage in importing nuclear fuel, something like that. Then the support rate drops down considerably. So it means that public, if informed well, they usually respond with a more intelligent answer. So in that sense, I agree that we need more education, but how precisely can you achieve that education?
That's a great question, and I'll give an inadequate answer, but clearly this seminar is exactly the kind of thing that we're trying to promote, which is why I'm such a big supporter of KAIST's efforts here, by educating not just grad students and assistant professors, but also bringing in undergraduates who can get inspired to continue working in this area, and then by having people from the future diplomatic corps all learning about these issues together, I think that's a very important thing. I also think all of us who are doing this as a profession have an obligation not just to publish our research in the best scholarly journals, but at the same time to take that research and try to use it for public education at the same time by publishing shorter pieces in the popular press and talking in public forums. The effort during the Cold War to educate the public to support arms control and not support pugnacious emotional responses took a long time. And I think we lost a lot of that sense during the post-World War period, but hopefully this program and many others like it can help try to restore that degree of education in our publics here and back in the United States.
Okay, so if you only need a comment or question, maybe I'll take the one more comment or questions.
My name is Steve Kang of Korea Institute of Nuclear Nonproliferation and Control. Well, the Rocket Man, as you see, recently launched 3 times the short-range ballistic missiles. I think this provocation imposed a direct threat to the national security of South Korea and Japan. However, the President Trump said he doesn't care about the launch of short-range missiles by North Korea. I think it seems that he doesn't care about the U.S. troops stationed in South Korea and Japan. The launch of a recent short-range ballistic missile is amount to a clear violation of U.S. Security Council sanctions resolution against North Korea. And my question is, I would like your comment on the Trump's very disappointing remarks.
My personal comment is that they are deeply disappointing. President Trump should have said that those are violations of the UN Security Council and that we stand by our allies and that must end as well. But the bottom line is that this is a good reason why we have to have an arms control agreement that lays out precisely what's permitted and what's not, rather than having just a handshake between President Donald Trump and Chairman Kim Jong-un. President Trump has every personal and I think domestic political reasons never to acknowledge failures. And I think that's what you're seeing here. But it is regrettable in terms of our reliance on our alliance together that he made those statements.
Okay, because of the schedule, I'd like to finish the keynote speech session. Let's give you one more time. We can the President, Professor Sagan, again.
Okay. Thank you very much.